Transmission begins.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
This is the Josh Tolley Show on the GCN Radio Network.
Our next guest is most famous for playing Axel on The Walking Dead. But he's one of those guys where when you see him, as soon as you see him, you're like, man, I know this guy. And then, you know, you hop on your phone, go to IMDb, and figure out he's been in, like, pretty much everything you've seen for the past 15 years. His name is Lew Temple. He's got a new movie coming out, and we're going to get to that as well. Welcome to the show, sir. How you doing?
Oh, Josh, so nice to be here. Thanks for having me this morning. Thank you.
Oh, pleasure having you. Pleasure having you.
Yeah, very cool.
So let's talk about this new film first, and then we'll kind of work back from it. This film's kind of it gets down to your bones, man. It's kind of like Ransom years ago with Mel Gibson, that sort of feel to it. What's it about? It's
an action thriller. First and foremost, you're going to be excited and on the edge of your seat, and within minutes of sitting down in the movie theater, you're taking the ride, and you're invested in it, and so it's going to keep you moving. And it is a moving picture. It's a car chase. This, unfortunately, is social commentary about what actually happens. Children are abducted, which is heinous and awful, and we're not propping that up by any means, but we are offering that it's a true story. And more than that, a mother's determination, her fortitude, her will, and pursuit to get her child back. You know, the numbers say that when your child is taken and if he or she is out of your sight for, I believe it's 7 hours, that there's a good chance you won't see them again. And somehow she reasons this. And we all go through, we have cell phones, but occasionally we don't charge them or we misplace them. And right when you need them, she doesn't have it. And she knows that she can't pull over to get the type of support or help from the authorities. And she just keeps going. So as she keeps going, she starts having small victories that turn into larger victories. And so the real story here and the message is, Josh, that we all have mothers, and ever since they brought us into this world, they've been heroes for us. Your mom would do anything for you and has since the minute you started walking till you fell down on your bicycle till you said, I'm going to be a radio celebrity. She has backed you 100%, and if all that went south, she would be there to pick you up as well. And this is that story, and I think it champions that. And then I would say that Miss Berry presents this in such a, you know, with such grace and integrity, but passion, it's real visceral, and it's hard not to get behind her. So it's a great story and a great win situation. So unfortunately, it's about a child being abducted, the old Amber Alert, which, you know, when we see that, I think every one of us who are parents cringe a little bit, and we think about our own in that scenario.
Well, you know, obviously my mom won't listen to this show, so she now loves you.
Well, I love her for having you and pushing you to do this, dude. She got you going.
Well, you mentioned something, you know, you said it so nonchalantly, Miss Berry, but we're not talking about any Miss Berry. We're talking about Halle Berry, and you are the one who took her kid. So what was it like working with Halle Berry?
Well, the obvious, you know, the things that show up first are, you know, obviously she's very appealing. But beyond that, she's entirely talented. She's an artist, and she's gracious. She's very kind. She's really maternal. She makes sure, as a person outside of the professional that you are, that you're okay. How's your hotel room? Are you eating well? Have you got enough sleep in your new environments? We're down here for 2 months. I know you're away from your family. Your daughter's the same age as mine. Is that okay? How you doing? Let's bring them down here. I mean, she's really tuned in to what the comfort level of making a better day at work is. Outside of that, or getting into the meat of it, she's amazing as an artist. Josh, a very difficult thing is to carry a picture by yourself. And when I say this, I don't mean with lesser supporting actors. I mean in a cab of a vehicle by herself in desperate measures. And she's holding this up with close-ups all the way through. And so she maintains tension. She maintains anxiousness, quick decisions. I mean, she does so much with so little. She's not there's no call and response like you and I are doing right here. There's just her, and she is holding that up. And that people underestimate how the talent that it takes. And she's amazing. I find her ever since we first saw her to be what I call a great reactor. So she reacts to situations. One of the things that I did was I removed a lot of my dialogue from the script because I thought this would serve silent and violent, little Michael Myers, kind of the guy that doesn't negotiate with you. Those are always the creepiest, the guys that won't allow to you what they want. And she offers everything. And when you start bartering against yourself, you start telling on yourself. And I wanted to kind of unravel her this way. And I feel like it works really great. And she steps up. She's amazing. I've had the opportunity to work with some really fantastic actors, Denzel Washington, Tom Hardy, Chris Pine, Johnny Depp, and now Halle Berry, and she's right there toe-to-toe with them, no doubt.
Well, but you're there too. You are creepy as crap in this movie. How do you prepare to play a kidnapper?
Interesting. Clearly there's nothing that I've ever done that would associate with that, and you do have to find some dark things in your life. But more than that, I felt like Terry, my character, is really disconnected, and he's a little confused about the whole situation. He's very base and animalistic, takes a child, moves it through the system. Sadly, they part these children out like a stolen car, and you know, it's awful to talk, particularly nonchalantly, and I don't mean to do that, but I'm just trying to move through that subject. But this woman would not quit, and it puzzles him, and so I chose to sort of be interested in her. This is still chasing me. This is, why is she doing this? Why won't she give up? So I kind of took a fancy to her a little bit. And I always try to have a little bit of a soundtrack to my day and my work. And I remember doing this film, Radiohead's song Creep was a big kind of inspiration as we were moving through this. But yeah, the very difficult thing was that A, Miss Berry's so pleasant and kind, and B, the young man who's abducted, Sage Carrera, young actor, he's so fun, loves basketball, loves to play games. It was difficult to sort of get separate, like, look, we're going to work now, and you have to be afraid of me. I know we just played hide and seek, and that was fun. Now we're playing hide and seek, really, really scary, okay? So you've got to sort of break that smile down a minute. And that was as difficult as anything. I would say that in this role, I tried to be a bit more reclusive and less social than I am typically.
Well, sir, we're up against the break. Man, that went fast. We're up against the break. Stay where you're at, because I want to talk about this film, and then I want to talk about some of the stuff you've done in the past, too, and a connection that we actually have. So we'll get to that right after this.
Thanks, Josh.
All right, you're thinking about going to a movie this weekend. Obviously, The Dark Tower. There's no reality to that. There's no gunslinger going from one world to another. An emoji shouldn't have a movie at all. So if you're going to go see a movie, go see one that actually kind of speaks to the world you live in. And we're talking to the star of Kidnap, and that has Halle Berry in it as well, Lew Temple.
Thanks, Josh. That's very kind and effusive of you. Go see this movie. I mean, I feel like it's a movie for everybody, because we do take kind of the regular person. We always hear about this. What would we do? Could we do this? And these great stories, human interest stories, where people overcome their normalness to be superheroes. This is what she does. And we all, you report stories like this all the time. This does happen, and it's within you. And I think that's what the message is. It's like, look, dude, ladies, you got this in you, and fellas, you do too. We all got this. We're all Halle Berry in one way or another. So come on.
Well, and over 500 kids this year alone so far have been kidnapped just out of Washington, D.C. So this is something that's happening daily. And I think it just strikes a chord, whether your child has been kidnapped or not. It's something that you worry about.
Well, there
so
are,
this just kind of pulls on
as,
you.
Ebs, thank you. As a social commentary, you know, part of the backstory on this is that we did profile this young man. He obviously... He was. We were aware of him from the internet, from photos being posted by parents, family events, activities. Knew, in fact, he was going to a birthday party. That he was going to the park. Single mother getting off a shift. Single mother that's going to be rushed under a little bit of duress. Very heavy populated area. These are. You know, I hate that I know about all this, but this is part of the research that you do to build the character. I recognize as I travel a lot, I'm going to leave this call and head to Chicago. I'm in Los Angeles right now, and I'm in airports all the time. And we have a lot of security going into airports, not so much going out. Boy, when a mom is going to see dad somewhere with three kids and she's in a terminal or at a gate, and it's real easy, you know. So my message is hold on to your babies, man. Hold on to your babies, know where they are, and be careful about how you're putting them out there into the world.
Has this made you more careful?
Absolutely. Myself and my wife, when I was making this movie, she had a birthday party. I was in New Orleans doing this, and then they had a party at Griffith Park, a birthday party. And I just said, you know, I don't know. I feel like maybe this isn't the best thing to do. I just was nervous, and my wife is incredibly cautious, as it is anyway. And so, you know, we have these drop-off parties. You got to know the scenario. You got to. Today we do. When you and I grew up, Josh, maybe not so much. We rode our bikes all over the neighborhood, Mom knew that at 6 p.m. when dinner was served, you're home or you're punished. But it's so different today, right? I mean, and I hate that it is. I hate that it is. But we have to rise up to still protect our babies. So we can't complain about how it is today. The fact that all of our cell phones go off when a child is abducted, that didn't happen back when we were kids. So that's
point.
A good thing. You know, that's a good thing.
Yeah. Now, some of the stuff you've done in the past, obviously you are famous for Axel and The Walking Dead, which is just this massive international phenomenon of a show. But you were in Walker, Texas Ranger, too.
Yes.
And I'm actually really good friends with Mike Norris.
Oh, my gosh. Well, you know, I cut my teeth on that show. That was the very first network television show that I had ever done. And I was a Texas native at the time. And I was I got hired to do a guest star up there that recurred. I ended up doing about 4 years on this show. And Mike is so fantastic. The great thing about Walker, Texas Ranger was I learned how to be professional. The protocol, it was a stunt-driven show. These are the gentlemen that are protecting or, you know, in safety that do the stunts. Don't do your own stunts. These guys show up to do them. And when you do them, a director asks you to do them. These guys don't make the same pay on the day. So don't take money out of their mouth. So I learned the right way from Mike. And Mike directed a lot of episodes.
Yeah.
Mike ran the show. You know, Mike stepped in for Chuck on several occasions, stunt doubling. You know, and he's gone on to be a very prolific producer, writer, director. Mike's fantastic. And that was a great show. And every morning Chuck would get together like a coach and get us together and thank us for being there and for helping him. And for many years, that was the top show for CBS. Chuck Norris is a very solid person, a very solid individual. I know we make a lot of jokes and they're fun, but to be honest with you, you know, Chuck made that thing happen, and he was always very gracious to be part of the entertainment world. And he's a good dude, man.
Well, looking over all the people you've worked with, is there anybody who you're like, man, okay, so I've done a movie with Denzel Washington, I've done a movie with Halle Berry, Chuck Norris as in a TV show. Is there anybody on your list where you're like, man, I really want to work with this person?
Well, you know, Paul Newman was always the guy on
my
radar. And so recently he's come back in Cars. This Cars 3. So maybe somewhere, if there's a way that I can get into Cars as a voice to deal with Hudson, and they can recreate Newman's thing, maybe there's still a chance. There's so many guys. It'd be so hard to pinpoint a finger on, but I love Michael Shannon's work, actually. Sure. And it feels like he and I would click. You know, there feels like there's this sort of artistic endeavor that we could have and do some wrestling. There's just so many. I love Colin Firth. I think he's an amazing.
Oh yeah,
an amazing guy. But I've had the fortune to work with so many great guys. You know, Tom Hardy. He has this Brando magnetism. David Strathairn is a wordsmith. My delight was to work with someone.
Oh, did we lose you? Well, we got Lew Temple back. Lew, you had us scared for a minute. Thought you got kidnapped.
Oh, geez, I was kidnapped on the internet. I'm telling you, we had to resort back to our old Ma Bell telephone system here now.
But man.
But we're back, Josh. I apologize for that. I don't know. I can't explain that. So.
No worries. One thing I was looking forward to talking to you about when you were lined up to be on the show, Tim Tebow. You used to be a scout for the Mets.
Yeah, I love that Tim's given this a go. And, you know, he's starting to learn to play at that level. He's an incredible athlete. So having played baseball most of my life as a child and going through high school and then college, getting drafted, going out with the Mariners and playing in the minor leagues, traded to Houston, minor league guy, and then getting into the scouting world where you're going out to evaluate talent and project major league players for the future. You look at skill sets and athleticism, and certainly Tebow physically has all the, you know, the tools that are required. He just needs to get his reps in. Athletics, unlike art, requires a lot of repetition, and so he just, I think as he continues his reps and continues to play, he'll improve, and then we'll see to what level his athleticism is able to take him. I think all the naysayers, I would guess about 20% of them have gone on board because he's just continued to improve. But I love baseball. I loved looking at players. I was so fortunate to be in the Houston organization as well, and two of these guys just in the past 2 years have been voted into the Hall of Fame, Craig Biggio and Jeff Bagwell this year. And so I'm forever a fan and excited. And, you know, baseball is, for me, baseball is life. Baseball, if an alien, Josh, came to visit Earth, I would take him to a baseball game and say, this is what we do. I'm sure there'd be a lot of debate about that, but there's just a zen approach to the game. There's a social context to it that I think is just right, or at least for me, it's a sanctuary, and everything kind of falls into place when I'm at the ballpark.
So how did you make that transition of giving up baseball? Because like you said,
well,
you got drafted,
yeah,
and then now you're an actor.
That's a great, interesting story, because I really was on my way to being a front office executive, as it were. And I followed a girl into an acting class to chat up, get a date, the old girl thing. And I saw what they were doing on the stage, and I said, well, I could do that. And it kind of tickled my fancy, and I tried, and I could not do that. So I had to go back to college, Brooklyn College, and learn how to do that. And then at some point, had to make a decision that this is the pursuit that I was going to make. And I left an incredibly fortunate career in baseball to go chase this, you know, and left a real job, a career, you know, a company car expense account, salary, traveling all over the country, all over the world, looking for baseball players, the major league franchise organization, to go move furniture and do garage theater to see if I could make this work. So, I've been very, very fortunate. And, the one thing that I would say is that, you know, if you give yourself a chance, you'll surprise yourself, because the world's waiting for you to surprise it. And it's out there. It's an X file that you can solve. That's the truth.
Well, and anybody who's watched you as Axel looks at you, and then you take this baseball aspect to it and thinks, man, he would be perfect for a period piece on baseball.
Yeah, well, that'd be great, wouldn't it? Kind of redo some of that, the setting the bases back with the old Red Stockings in 1876, or pushing into the 1920s, maybe that Black Sox scandal again in Chicago,
that'd be a great one.
Maybe trading that pitcher Babe Ruth over from the Red Sox to become a great home run hitter for the Yankees, or. There's so many great baseball stories. There's so much lore to almost all pieces of the game. You know, the great things, and because of what you do, you're so aware of this. And when you got started, it's so different now. There's so much information, and there's hard to keep secrets.
Yeah.
But the secrets used to be the great stories. You know, the secrets that finally came out, you know, that I had a friend that was a scout for the Minnesota Twins. He mentored me, George Brophy, and he had a tryout camp, and he signed, there were three Cuban players, and he signed two of them, Rod Crew and Zoilo Versalles, but he let the other guy go home, and the other guy was Fidel Castro. And had he signed Fidel Castro, how would the world be? You know, that's so bizarre. It's just great stories. I think baseball has those kinds of great stories. I can remember the Houston Astros had the very first pick in the nation, and there was this kid, Derek Jeter. What would Derek Jeter have been as a Houston Astro? I don't think the same as he was as a New York Yankee. So it's just so great. So I love all the baseball stories.
Well, now if somebody sends you a script in the next month or so and says, hey, you know what, we want you to be in the baseball movie, just this is why, this interview right now.
Can I send it to you to read, to sign off on it? You could do play by play. Maybe you could go up and be Joe Buck up in the grandstand up there. Be Harry Carey.
Bob Uecker, man.
Bob Uecker is he is the best. He's an all timer. That guy. He's great when he's not in baseball. He's great in my world right now in entertainment. It's Mr. Belvedere.
Oh, yeah.
He's fantastic.
Yeah, and the Major League series. Bob Uecker is so good. I mean, this kind of went on a weird baseball tangent, and everybody's got to remember go see Kidnap. But Bob Uecker is so good that I would rather listen to Bob Uecker call the game than watch the game on TV.
Yeah, he's fun. He's fun. And he brings it. He's like that really that crazy uncle that shows up every now and again, but you love it, you know?
Yeah.
And he just makes it so much fun. And because he played and he lived it, and he's self-evasive, he makes fun of himself. And it's good, but it's hard to laugh at yourself. So anyone that can, that's a talent too. You know, it's great. He's great. Uke's great.
Let's get back to you though. In your film career, how do you transition out of this? I mean, you have this kind of dark thing with Walking Dead. You have a definitely dark image with playing a kidnapper. How do we get a comedy under your belt, or how do you pick a role to kind of diversify your palette there?
Yeah, I've been fortunate because I'm really tuned into independent films to be diverse and to not get sort of stereotyped, though I rather am as a colloquial Southern type of character actor, but to do different characters and different navigate through the independent film world. Now that independent film world is not as strong as it was based on, again, our different venues for entertainment. This whole streaming world has changed the gig. So you don't go to an art house movie theater to watch one of my art house films as much as you used to. So, but I've had decent taste, I would say, in looking at material and being able to select, well, I just did that. Maybe I should try and do something a little different. And about the time that the big mustache starts becoming my brand, I just shaved that off to do a period piece called The Iron Orchard, which is a 1940s There Will Be Blood type of movie about pulling oil out of West Texas, a boom or bust story. And that felt good to get in those old clothes and to be clean shaven and take 10 years off my face and to be a different guy. And I always appreciate changing it up. I think you do have to have to keep it mixed up because we get set in our ways. And that goes with our business too. Just about the time, you know, as a former athlete, I always look at my career and say, well, here's my baseball card, read the stats on the back, and here's where I should be. But I realize my game changes quite a bit and quite often. So I have to keep changing too. Otherwise, I'm going to be down in La Brea tar pits like a dinosaur. You know, it's extinct.
Well, Lew Temple, thank you so much for joining us, man. It was a blast. Everybody, you got to go see Kidnap this weekend, too.
Thanks so much, Josh. It was really great to visit with you, and congratulations on all the good work you do. Keep doing that, man. We love your show, so thank you for having me.
Oh, thank you so much. Folks, that does it for today. We are out of here. So remember, look into jury nullification. No victim, no crime. Today, tomorrow, and always, may your path lead to heaven, and may freedom follow in your footsteps.